three, two, one, launch.
Soviet Russia scores a dramatic victory.
The Soviet Union was winning the race to space, and the United States was struggling to catch up.
I ask you, sir, what are we going to do about it?
After so many setbacks, what lengths would the Americans go to surpass their superpower rival?
Seeing if they could knock a Russian satellite out of orbit or completely destroying a Russian satellite.
So it sounds crazy. It sounds like a movie plot.
Did the U.S. military create an undercover astronaut program to spy on the Soviets?
The whole idea was to put one of the biggest cameras ever created into a orbiting space station. That was totally secret. The public had no knowledge about that.
Wow.
And would the U.S. go so far as to kidnap a Soviet spacecraft to obtain new technologies?
If there was ever any hint that the Soviets knew what happened, you know, the CIA never caught wind of it. So it seems like they got away with this epic, historic thing that is insane.
A former FBI agent, a conspiracy theorist, and former aerospace consultant, and an American astronaut are investigating the truth behind the moon landing.
The conspiracy theory is alive and well, and so is our investigation. We've discovered some surprising secrets lurking at the edges of the space race to the moon.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
President John F. Kennedy boldly challenged the United States and NASA to put a man on the moon by the end of the decade.
The space race was on.
Yeah, and we were behind. It would take much more than President Kennedy's dreams to get the U.S. to the moon before the Soviet Union. The U.S. was trailing far behind the Soviets in the race to space. Even before NASA had opened its doors in 1958, the USSR had already launched Sputnik into space, the world's first artificial Earth satellite.
President, Russia has launched an Earth satellite. They also claim to have had a successful firing of the intercontinental ballistic missile. What are we going to do about it?
NASA didn't seem to have the right stuff to develop the rocket technology to get to the moon and leap past the Soviets.
The United States space effort takes a giant step as scientists and technicians prepare to orbit Eno, a 5-year-old chimpanzee, around the Earth.
That's why many conspiracy theorists think there was a cover-up and we didn't actually land on the moon in 1969. How could we have caught up to the Soviets and beat them to the moon? I mean, the Russians have already sent a man into space, and we're still sending chimps.
The U.S. had already brought over 1,600 former Nazi scientists and engineers to work on military and space programs. It was clear that the U.S. wasn't playing games. Would we use Cold War espionage tactics to gain an advantage and catch up?
Mike and I are here at the KGB Museum in New York City to sit down with astrojournalist Tariq Malik. He's editor-in-chief of space.com.
It's like the craziest story about this period of time we don't know.
The CIA actually kidnapped a Soviet spacecraft to see how it ticked.
Oh, wait, kidnapped?
Yes.
Okay, listen, give us more details.
All right, yeah. No, so it sounds crazy. It sounds like a movie plot. Well, in 1959, you know, the Soviet Union was really riding high. They had launched Sputnik and wowed the world. They built the first spacecraft to touch the moon, Luna 1, you know, also known as the Lunik program.
Soviet Russia scores a dramatic victory in the exploration of space with the launching of the first rocket to hit the moon. Western observers monitored Lunik's two radios to the very moment of impact.
And they went on a global roadshow to show off their successes to other countries, to show just kind of how far ahead that they were. One of the exhibits that was in this roadshow was a Lunik spacecraft.
The Lunik wasn't just some Russian satellite. It was the first man-made object to ever reach the moon. The Lunik made impact with the moon at a velocity of about 7,500 miles per hour. At that point, the U.S. thought its guidance systems were superior to the Russians. But when the Lunik hit its target, it proved that their guidance systems were better. The closest that the United States had ever gotten to the moon was 37,000 miles away. The Lunik also made history by, for the first time, photographing the far side of the moon, which is not viewable from Earth.
So the CIA think this is the real deal. And it would be nice if we could actually get access to this thing, if we could see how it ticks. The more you know about this spacecraft, how much it weighs dry, that you can infer how much it weighs with fuel on board. But they have this guard that's there 24 hours a day watching over this thing. So how are you going to get access to it?
So what was their plan?
They watched and they figure out that at the end of the exhibit, when it's going to move to a new location, they can arrange for it to get on the last truck out to the train. And as it goes out, they have a car in the front and a car in the back to make sure the Soviets aren't following them or caught wind of their plan. And when they're confident, then they pull the car over at the last turn off to the train station.
Tariq tells us that many of the facts in this mission have been redacted by the CIA. But the best we can tell, this took place sometime in Mexico in 1959. The driver was probably a non-Russian, and the CIA convinced him to rest overnight at a hotel rather than drive on.
The CIA had their own driver, and they drove it to a scrapyard that they had rented out just for this, and they have a whole team come in. They had already been watching this crate. You know, it's a one big crate on this truck. They got to go in through the roof. They take their shoes off so that they have just their socks on because they don't want to leave any footprints or evidence behind that they're there. It's 7 o'clock at night when they think that their coast is clear. They open up the top of this crate. They go inside. They took it apart. They kept a close record. They have people with cameras. They took a bunch of pictures and then sent the film back to the field office to make sure the camera was working so that they wouldn't, you know, find out that they left the lens cap on later or had a bad batch of film.
You don't take on a mission like this unless you're fully committed. The risk of getting exposed or caught would have been more significant in the Cold War than the actual intel itself. So the details they were looking for must have been considered very important.
They do that till 4 o'clock in the morning. They put it back together again, and then they put the lid on the crate. You know, woke up the driver that they had sequestered overnight and just drove a Lunik back and left the truck there. It seemed like no one was the wiser, but at the end of the day, they had detailed information about what this spacecraft looked like, how it was put together, what it weighed, what the rocket they needed to launch it, and they could use that information to infer so many other things about the rocket program. It sounds insane.
Still, any way we could get new and important information, we had to do it. And the Americans did come away with the kind of specific details they needed to send a spacecraft to the moon. Details like how much the Lunik weighed, how big it was, and how much fuel it had on board.
If there was ever any hint that the Soviets knew what happened, you know, the CIA never caught wind of it. So it seems like they got away with this kind of epic historic thing, and we only found out about it later when they declassified it in the early 2000s.
Straight up spy movie stuff, right? To conspiracy theorists, this feeds into the idea that the Americans had no choice but to resort to a moon landing hoax because US space technology just wasn't good enough. They would say that's why we had to go to desperate extremes. We had to steal Russian information.